treatment outcomes for individual patients. So one of the recent trends we see a lot in healthcare is that we try to personalize medical decisions, but also we try to personalize healthcare itself, and that requires to make a more individual assessment of how people will benefit from treatment. And so my talk will be about this topic today. So who am I? So I'm an assistant professor at the University Medical Center, and more specifically at the Julius Center, where I do a lot of research in statistical methods for both for risk prediction and for evidence synthesis. So I've quite a couple of slides for today. I may not be able to go through everything, so I might skip a few things here and there. So let's see how that works. But so in general, so I will give a short introduction. So what is prediction? So for those for you who might not be familiar with prediction. And then I want to focus on, I think, four main themes. So one is machine learning. Most likely you will have heard about this. Then one of it will be penalization. Then I will also talk about evidence synthesis. And finally about modeling of treatment effects. And so this project is related to is partially funded by the European Commission. So I'm leading one project. It's called RECODIT, where we try to develop a statistical methodology for facilitating data sharing and more specifically for facilitating pooled data analysis across infectious disease cohorts. So a lot of the methods I will be talking about today is a part of RECODIT, and it also serves to assist the platform of RECODIT. So some background. So what is prediction? So we'll keep it very simple. So prediction is really about trying to predict something that we don't know, and this unknown can either be something that's already present. So like in the field of disease, it can be, you know, the presence of a disease, like diagnosis. So we could try to predict, do I have COVID, yes or no? So this could be a prediction. But it could also be something about the future. So again, I could try to predict, will I, you know, what's my chance to get infected by coronavirus within the next, I don't know, 30 days. And then, so you can imagine that I can make predictions by considering a lot of features about myself, but also about my environment and maybe my medical history and so forth. And in medical field, we often talk about absolute risk because the outcomes are often binary or dichotomous, like death or alive or infected, yes or no. So many other outcomes that are relevant for decision-making are often simplified to binary outcomes. And this is because we want to either identify high-risk individuals. For instance, with coronavirus, we might want to predict who is high risk of you know, being infected by coronavirus, because then we could prioritize decisions or policies to those types of individuals. For instance, vaccination. We could also try to predict, you know, who has the highest chance of dying from coronavirus, and then, you know, again, you know, prioritize our policies to those type of individuals. And predictions are also made for identifying treatment effects. So in general, how treatments work now, or how it works now, usually is that when drug developers make a new treatment or a new intervention, they run a couple of trials, and then they make a certain assessment about the average effect of the treatment on the population. And then it's generally assumed that everyone experience the same benefits in that population. But this doesn't always has to be the case. So it's very well possible that some individuals have a stronger benefit from receiving treatment than other individuals, even if the overall effect is the same for all individuals. So prediction can also be used to try to assess, is it worth for me to take a certain intervention? How much will I benefit? How much survival will I gain by going through a certain surgical procedure? And will to what extent will that gain in survival really be relevant for me or for you or for some other patient? So it really helps prediction of absolute treatment effects or of personalized treatment effect can really help to tailor decision-making to individual patients and to, yeah, indeed to target decision-making to individuals. And so then the key question is, of course, so how can we predict? And so, because prediction is really about individual outcomes, individual patients, it's really important to consider individual characteristics. So everyone is different, right? So we try to use information that is specific to each individual, but that's also tells us something about the presence of the disease or their future occurrence of disease. And so typically age is most often is almost always an important predictor of anything, because as you get older, a lot of bad things happen. So age, almost any prediction task, age is always there as a predictor, and gender quite often as well. But then other than that, we often have a lot of additional variables that are often relevant and very specific to different diseases. Like in heart disease, often we work with variables like blood pressure and maybe cholesterol levels, maybe some markers and so forth. But you could also think of imaging results like, I don't know, X-ray scans or maybe CT scans or, I don't know, many other types of information. So there is a huge amount of information that can be used, and some information is very easily accessible, like age and gender, and some information is much more difficult to obtain or to retrieve, or it can be very costly or maybe even harmful to a certain extent. So it's often not so straightforward to, you know, to find those predictors that give you a very high predictive accuracy, but that also are, you know, easy to obtain. So this is often one of the main challenges in risk prediction. And so prediction models have been around for a while. So this is one example. I think this is the, I think it's the score or the Euroscore. I'm not sure anymore which one this one is, but it essentially, so this is a risk calculator that has been implemented in a mobile app, and it predicts cardiovascular disease. So what you would have to fill in is, again, like age and gender, like I mentioned, smoking status, diabetes, and a couple of other things. And then it gives you a risk calculation. And so for this particular patient, so it was a woman, 40 years old, not smoker. So her risk of cardiovascular events within the next 10 years was predicted to be low. But there are other examples. And so there's a lot of theory about how to develop prediction models, how to validate them, and how to make these models. And so many people are, you know, developing models when they have some data available. So the literature is full of prediction models. And essentially the main recommendations when you are developing models is that you need to have a representative sample from, I don't know, a cohort study, for instance, and that the data set should be rather large. And then you can apply whatever you want. I mean, many prediction models are developed using regression, but also, I mean, increasingly often you see people adopting machine learning and other methods. So, and of course, developing a model is one thing, and then of course, we want that this model is actually accurate, that it gives us, you know, and that is helpful in practice. So we are developing these models with a purpose, right? So we want that it has some impact. And so we also have studies that can quantify the impact of a model to a certain degree. And in this type of studies, we typically look at four different elements of the model, which we call calibration. So to what extent are predicted risks, do they correspond to observed risks? And we also quantify discrimination. So to what extent can the model separate between people who develop the event and people who do not develop the event? Then to what extent can we apply the model across different settings and populations without losing any, let's say, calibration and discrimination? And then finally, to what extent do these risk predictions also, you know, change patients' outcomes? And then so in the past, I think many metrics, but also methods have mostly focused on just quantifying, let's say, performance of the model. So just quantifying something like accuracy, C-index, true positive, false positive, calibration metrics and so forth. So a lot of numerical metrics in a single data set that can quantify to some extent to what extent the predictions are accurate, yes or no. But more recently, we found that this might not always be sufficient to really, you know, quantify whether this model will be useful in practice. And so we've started to make a distinction between, let's say, what we call the reproducibility and the transportability of prediction model. And so what we did in the past a lot was focus on reproducibility of the model. So we would, I don't know, do something like a split sample validation or a cross validation or a bootstrap validation, and then quantify all these metrics. And what that really tells us is how the model would perform if we were to apply the model in new patients from exactly the same population as the data set from which we derived the model, which of course in theory is a nice idea, but the reality is that once we develop a model, you know, people start using it in populations that are always a bit different, or sometimes even quite a lot different from the original population. And sometimes that's intentional, sometimes it's not. For instance, I mean, populations change over time because treatment changes and policies changes, but also the behavior of population changes over time. So when you predict a certain outcome using, you know, by looking at the correlations in a certain data set, those correlations might have existed, I don't know, 2 years ago, 1 year ago, or 2 months ago, but they might no longer be the same today. So when you develop a prediction model, you could say in a certain way that as soon as your model is developed, it's already outdated, because people change, populations change. Even if you apply the model to the same hospital in the same clinical practice, at some point, the model will no longer, you know, be fully representative anymore for your original development data set. So what we do increasingly often these days is we try to assess how well a model is transportable across different populations. And this requires us to actually apply the model to new data sets, and preferably not just one new data set, but preferably, you know, multiple data sets that all differ in some way from the original development sample. And what we have seen in the last few years, just the last, I don't know, 5 to 10 years, is that once we start validating these prediction models in new data sets, is that many of these models that are available in the literature, they do not predict as well as we thought they would predict, but also that often they do not really make any difference in clinical practice, or they do not improve patient outcomes. And one of the deficiencies that we see a lot is that many of the models are developed in very small data sets, so these are problems that can be avoided, but also that these data sets are often very local and very they're very limited representativeness for let's say other hospitals in Netherlands, or other hospitals, or other clinical practices that you encounter in real life. And finally, there is still a lack of assessments that try to quantify how well prediction models work in, you know, in real life. So there is a famous quote. So it says all models are wrong, and only some are useful. And the real trick is to find those models that are useful. That is a real challenge. And so my talk today is a bit about some new methods and some new strategies that have emerged over the past couple of years that try to facilitate the development of prediction models that are more generalizable across different settings and populations. So the methods that aim to make it a bit easier to make a model that you can develop today that will be accurate today, but that will also be accurate when you apply tomorrow in the same hospital or in a different hospital. Sorry, I think there's some chats. Okay, so let me just have a look. So there is one question. So is transportability the same as generalizability? So this is really a matter of definition. So I would say no. So I consider generalizability when you have evidence that the model transports well to multiple settings. So when I talk about transportability, I mean that, let's say I have data set A where I develop my model, and then I have another data set from, I don't know, another hospital, and I apply my model to this other data set, and it turns out my model performs well in that second data set, then I could say, okay, my model shows good transportability from data set A to B. And when I can show this multiple times, so my model transports well from A to B, but also from A to C and from A to D, then I have some evidence that my model is generalizable. So there will always be some limit, of course, to how generalizable a model is. And that's what you try to evaluate, you know, you try to assess the boundaries of this generalizability by performing this, you know, assessments across multiple hospitals, across multiple data sets. But like I said, it's a matter of definition, because different people, they consider it the same thing, or they have still a different interpretation of these terms. So that's always a bit the trick with, I would say with epidemiology or statistics, that there's not always a clear consensus on the meaning of certain words. So first of all, so I would like to give a bit more depth into machine learning. So machine learning is, I mean, it's a really big term. I mean, today, if you want to be hip and modern, you just have to slip in the word machine learning in any sentence when you describe whatever you're doing, because then suddenly you become very interesting. And so, but machine learning has been around also for quite a while now. And it has been, I don't know, it has emerged in quite a couple of fields. So when I was studying AI, so artificial intelligence, we used machine learning to try to beat games like chess and other games. And essentially many of these machine learning methods were a kind of brute force algorithm to try out all sorts of possibilities and then pick the ones that were the most the most successful. But so of course AI has also and machine learning have also found applications outside game theory. And just to come back on this, so last year that we had the ICB, so it's the conference for biostatistics, and so one of the founders of machine learning, or one of really important figures in machine learning, is Leo Bryman, who developed a lot of methods that are considered the foundations of machine learning. And he would describe the difference between machine learning and statistics as follows, where he would say that in statistics, you typically assume that there is a kind of data generation model. So you work with all these distributions, like a normal distribution or a binomial distribution, that describe, you know, how does the data behave, where does it come from? And then you use these distributions to make all the different models. And then the generic idea in machine learning is often that the methods that they propose in machine learning is that they try to avoid making these assumptions about distributions, and they come up with different models that do not necessarily make as strong assumptions as we have in statistics. So that's one way of describing machine learning. But to my experience, there's also a lot of similarities with what we do in statistics. So I don't really see it as a dichotomy, but there are some important differences. And so in machine learning, what we see a lot is that there is a very strong focus on prediction, but especially on classification tasks. So really on a lot of the methods in machine learning have emerged in scenarios where we want to make groups, right? We don't necessarily want to make a prediction about what is the risk of, I don't know, of developing cancer, but rather does this person has cancer, yes or no? And then, you know, to really about making groups. And then many of the machine learning methods are not stochastic. So many methods are not really probabilistic. They don't really have like this data models behind them. And so they are more pragmatic. For instance, they would try to identify individuals who are very similar, or they would try to partition, the different individuals into different groups that look similar. But then some methods then are similar to regression, like neural networks have some similarities, but also support vector machines. There is some similarities to what we have with regression. But the general idea of machine learning is that they try to avoid explicit modeling assumptions, like we have in regression, like assuming that there's some linear effects that add up on a certain scale. And by avoiding these assumptions, machine learning methods are considered to be extremely flexible, but also extremely data hungry. And then so in healthcare, so what kind of data is being used for machine learning and for prediction? So this is like what I mentioned before, so a lot of imaging data, but also text data. So very complex data usually is used in combination with machine learning, because that's the kind of data where this flexibility is really needed. And then so I mean, yeah, so I throughput data from wearables and laboratory data. And so what we have seen in the past few years is that machine learning has made really important contributions in the field of image recognition and image analysis, but also analysis of unstructured data like text, and other problems where we have a lot of what we call a high signal to noise ratio. But so the last couple of years, the expectations of machine learning are extremely high. And what we've seen in the last couple of years is that people also now try to apply machine learning to data where where we don't have these kind of complexities, like the data we collect in epidemiological studies. So data where we have like age and gender and maybe blood pressure and things like that. So the type of studies I'm involved in, it's typically not the kind of big data that you would obtain from, let's say, imaging or text retrieval. So we have a lot of patients, but we don't have a lot of variables that we collect. But the variables that we collect often already contain a lot of information. So if you have one variable like age or gender, just having that variable already gives you a huge amount of information with respect to something like cardiovascular disease or mortality or any other clinical outcome. So the necessity of complex modeling is much lower than when you would be working, for instance, with imaging data, where let's say one variable is, yeah, of course, it could be, you know, a row in your, a certain position, a certain pixel in your image. It doesn't say anything on itself. It needs to be analyzed as a part of the bigger picture to have some meaning. So this is very different. And so what we see a lot in studies that adopt machine learning in low dimensional or not necessarily low dimensional data, but in epidemiological data, is that they're not often not very successful or not very, they don't really offer great advantages. So the gains have been very limited in structured epidemiological data sets. And apart from that, another problem with machine learning methods or traditional machine learning methods is that they're not really designed for causal inference. So they are, because they avoid making assumptions so explicitly, it's very hard to interpret any model output with respect to causal pathways. And of course, I mean, there are developments in this area that try to change this, but from the basics, they're not really fit for this kind of purpose. Let's see if I can go to the next slide. So just to give some examples. So, I mean, these are just a couple of papers that I've tried to apply machine learning to predict clinical outcomes using epidemiological data. I mean, like age and gender and blood markers and so forth. And so the general message is that it can be done, but you can as well do it with regression. There is not really a clear advantage to predict clinical outcomes using machine learning. So of course, regression is not perfect. So all the models that we developed so far, they always have deficiencies. So they always have problems with respect to generalizability. They always need to be updated to adapt it and so forth. And so at some point, the hope was that machine learning would solve this problem. But so far, we haven't really solved this problem using machine learning or using any other method. So, it's still a problem. And machine learning didn't really solve it as far as I know. And so my impression, at least, is that machine learning may not yet be suitable for prediction of it's suitable for prediction of clinical outpoints, but because it is very data hungry, it may not yet be suitable for prediction of absolute treatment effects in routine care. So you can use it, but it's not suitable because A, you need a lot of data to use it, and B, you cannot directly infer causal effects from this machine learning method. So this combination makes it rather problematic. So that brings me to another possible pathway that we can consider to improve patients' prediction of patient outcomes, but also to improve prediction of treatment effects in individual patients. And so penalization, of course, is an element that we see a lot in regression, but also in machine learning, penalization is being applied increasingly often. The idea of penalization is really to deal with overfitting, so to deal with models that are complex and estimated in small data sets to avoid the fact that they are, you know, too much tailored to the data. And what is overfitting? So overfitting is really when you start modeling noise, so when you start interpreting noise as a signal, when it's just, you know, it doesn't mean anything. When you are overfitting a model, it means that you will generate inaccurate predictions for new patients. So, I mean, your model is extremely accurate for the 5 or the 10 patients you have in your data set, but if you add an 11th patient and you only make a prediction for that patient, when you have an overfitted model, that prediction will be completely off scale. And for instance, typically what we see is that overfitted models are, they generate predictions that are too extreme. So they give predicted risks that are too high for patients that have high risk and predictions that are too low for patients that are low risk. So they would say, let's say I have 80% of developing, I don't know, some cardiovascular disease. Rather than predicting 80%, for me it would predict 100%. And for someone that has a low risk, like, I don't know, 10%, 20%, it would predict 0%. And so methods to avoid overfitting have been developed over a couple of years. And typically what they try to do is they try to regularize the complexity of the model. And in regression, this is usually done by adding more assumptions. But it can also be done in different ways, for instance, by shrinking the predictions toward the average risk. So the extremities of the predictions disappear to some extent. But it can also be done more adaptively, for instance, by building in some procedures that constrain the magnitude of the regression coefficients, or in machine learning methods. It can be done, for instance, in decision trees by constraining the depth of the tree or the width of the tree. And again, in regression, it can also be done by including penalty terms, which is again related to the constraint of the magnitude of the regression coefficients. So typical methods that adopt shrinkage are lasso. You might be familiar with that. So lasso is one of these methods that's both considered a statistical method as a machine learning method, just like Rich and some other ones. And so this is just an example where you can see that. So this is a model that has been developed using a different couple of methods. And so what you can see is that, so they've applied regular regression to a data set, and then they applied rich regression and lasso regression. And then they compare the predicted risk versus the actual risk. And so what you see is that the standard regression, so especially let's say in this last category. So in the last category, you see a lot that the standard regression gives a much higher predicted risk than observed. So it really overestimates the predicted outcome risk. But if you apply shrinkage, this discrepancy is much lower. And also you see in the low risk category that again, the regular regression underestimates the absolute outcome risk, whereas again, the penalized versions, they do a better job. And so penalization methods have been developed. They are already available for quite some time, so they're nothing new. What is missing is a bit penalization methods for more complex data types. So for, let's say, for linear regression and for binary outcomes, these methods are available. But for time-to-event outcomes, so penalization methods are underdeveloped. So they're not unavailable because, like for Cox regression, lasso and rich have been developed. But Cox regression is not really suitable for making prediction models because Cox regression doesn't parameterize the baseline hazard. So it means that if you want to make predictions for new patients for new time points, it's not very suitable. So other methods have been proposed that kind of take over some of the properties of Cox regression, but that makes it easier to make absolute risk predictions. And one of these methods is, for instance, Royson-Palmer models that use a sort of spline for the baseline hazard. So these methods work great. The only point is that for these more new methods, we don't have penalization algorithms available yet. So one of the things we have been working on is to extend the lasso and rich penalties in Royson-Palmer models. So we can actually take the same paradigm from developing prediction models that are prone protected against overfitting, but also apply these methods to survival outcomes so that we can not just predict will someone die, yes or no, but that we can actually predict what's the time by which a person will die or will develop a certain outcome. And so we've extended these Royson-Palmer models with penalty terms that resemble the lasso and the rich approach in linear and logistic regression. And we're working on a couple of extensions that work either on the log cumulative hazard scale or the hazard scale itself. And the main idea is that why do we need this? So we need this. We need is to some extent to predict just survival outcomes, like for a patient, what's the chance that they will develop a certain outcome. So for any prediction model, this is helpful and important to apply a penalization. But it is especially important when we develop treatment effect models. So when we are developing models that predict the outcome under different treatments. So if you want to predict what is the chance that this person will die if they receive treatment A, and what is the person that this person will die if they receive treatment B? And then we can use this difference to try to evaluate what is the best treatment for this particular person. So for to develop this kind of models, it's really challenging because you need data from randomized trials, ideally, and you need to the models are more complex because treatment is an important element of these prediction models, and so to make these complex models, penalization is really important. So this is why survival models with a penalty term is, at least in my opinion, will be an important tool that should be available in the toolbox of many epidemiologists in the forthcoming years. So these are some technical details, so I will skip these for the sake of time. But if there are questions, I can come back on this at the end of the talk. So we did some simulations as well to compare Royston-Palmer models with Cox regression models that do and do not adopt penalization. And the general findings is, of course, that penalization helps, especially when you have small data sets and very complex models with interactions and so forth. And the main advantage of this Royston-Palmer models is that they are very flexible. So you can make, by default, of course, models are simple because they assume some linearity, but because Royston-Palmer adopts a flexible approach to deal with the baseline hazard, splines, we can model very complex outcomes, but also we can allow for non-proportional hazards through interaction terms. And if we have this penalization implied in the model, in the estimation, allowing for non-proportional hazards becomes a lot easier as well. The only limitations that we have so far and that we are trying to solve is that we have the starting values of the optimizer that have some that can have some role. And so we try to fix that issue. So you might think, so penalization and overfitting. So, I mean, this is nothing new. So this has also been around and recognized for the last, I think, 10, 50 years, maybe. No, not 50. Yeah, well, something, at least in the last century. And so methods are there. And so, okay, so you have small data sets, you should apply penalization. I think that's a given now. I think you should always apply penalization, even in large data sets. It turns out, actually, a recent study has looked into these penalization methods a bit in more depth. But it turns out that also penalization doesn't always help. And that in small data sets, shrinkage can even make things worse. So it's not a solution to fix all your problems. So shrinkage, I mean, it helps when you can develop a sensible model, but it doesn't help you to develop smaller studies and to develop reliable prediction models when you don't have a lot of data. So it's an important tool, but it's still not a solution to making prediction models that are more generalizable. And a second problem with overfitting is that it doesn't really deal with transportability. So what penalization does, it tries to improve your predictions when you are applying the model to new patients from the same original population. But as I mentioned before, ideally you want to apply the model to new populations, to populations that are a bit different. And penalization doesn't do anything with that. So it doesn't really touch upon the issue of generalizability. It mostly tries to improve the reproducibility of your model in new patients from the original population. So what I've been focusing on the last 5 to 10 years is to look at different strategies that try to leverage information from multiple sources at once to try to ascertain how much is transportability an issue, how much do we have to deal with differences between studies and populations, and can we directly build this kind of differences and heterogeneity in the model estimation procedure. And so I'll skip this, I think, some unpublished data. And so where I really see an important advantage is the what I call the meta-analysis of patient-level data. So what it really means, what I really mean by that is that what I think is becoming increasingly helpful and informative is to combine patient-level data from multiple sources, so from either multiple data sets, by forming a consortium and sharing, I don't know, data sets from, I don't know, study A with another study in the UK and maybe another study in Norway. but also data sets that are obtained on a national scale, for instance, through registries, large registries that, you know, collect a lot of data in a routine setting. And how are these data sets different from traditional data sets and cohort studies? Well, the main difference is that these data sets, well, of course, they are bigger, but the main difference is that they are clustered. So they have individuals from different settings, different populations at once. And so this offers many advantages. So first of all, of course, you have a bigger sample size. You also have more variability in the patients that you encounter in these data sets. But most importantly, is that these data sets contain some differences that you expect to encounter when you apply a model in new settings and new populations. So some of these differences that will happen when you apply a model in practice, you can find these differences by, you know, combining data sets from different locations. And so one example is the Q Research database in the United Kingdom, where it's a registry of UK practices. And so one of the models that they developed is QRisk. So it's, I think, for what's the outcome again of QRisk? I think it's also a cardiovascular outcome. And so what they did, so they developed a prediction model for, I think it was cardiovascular outcome, and they validated it not just in one data set, but they validated this prediction model in the entire QRisk database. So they actually ascertained whether this QRisk prediction model performs well locally in each, you know, of these 364 UK practices. So you don't have just one estimate of QRisk, how well does QRisk perform in a single data set in a single hospital. But now it becomes possible to really ascertain how does QRisk perform, not just in the United Kingdom in general, but, you know, in all these different locations within the United Kingdom. And then so you can actually study on average whether QRisk performs well, but also how much variation do we see in the performance of QRisk when we apply it locally in all these different settings and practices. And so what we found here, at least, is that the average performance and also the local performance was quite stable. And actually the QRisk, in several ways, it performs quite well, both locally and globally, at least within the United Kingdom. And then so recently we extended the method, or we sort of developed the method to try to exploit this kind of multiple data sets availability during the development of prediction models. So it's easy to exploit this information when you have already a model established and you want to evaluate the generalizability of model, because then you just apply the model to all these different clusters or all these different data sets, and you can just, you know, summarize the performance across all these data sets. So that's the easiest thing to do. But ideally, when you have all these data sets available and you still have to make a model, you would like to exploit the information of this heterogeneity during the development. And so how can you do this in an effective way? So, I mean, this is a kind of question that is still being answered, or methods are still being developed to address this. But one way is to apply what we call internal external cross-validation. And so what we do there is similar to cross-validation. So what we do is let's say we have 10 data sets. So you would use 9 data sets to develop a model, and then we would validate it in the remaining data set. And then we would iterate this until all data sets have been held out one time. And so what this method really allows us to do is to ascertain, if we are developing a method using a certain strategy, how well does this strategy gives us a model that is transportable to a whole new data set, to a whole new population. So this internal external cross-validation really allows us to get some understanding of whether our method or whether our strategy for developing a model will give us something that is to some extent generalizable across different settings and populations. And so this is a method that we recently adopted for making a prediction model for predicting ALS disease. So here we had patient level data from 14 cohort studies, which were, each of them was actually a specialized ALS center. And we try to predict, very serious outcomes like non-invasive ventilation or death. And so we apply this internal external cross-validation. So of course, in the 13 data sets that we used for development, we still had to make a decision, how are we going to combine these 13 data sets? And we didn't really have, there are not really methods available yet to develop prediction models using cluster data. So we had to use traditional methodology that doesn't really distinguish between these different clusters, but at least we could evaluate using internal external cross-validation whether it would be a problem to combine these data sets and whether this model that we were developing using this Royston-Palmer modeling would be generalizable when we apply to a new hospital. And so what we found is that the generalizability of our model was quite good, actually. So we found that across all these different holdout centers, the discrimination of our model remained fairly high and fairly consistent also across all the different data sets. But we also found that the calibration of the model was quite consistent, and there was some variation, but it was not that problematic. So basically, using the internal external cost validation approach, we could kind of convince ourselves that even though we don't have the methods yet to fully exploit the heterogeneity that might be present in the data, at least we can quantify to what extent it would give us a problem by ignoring it, right? So because we could quantify by developing our model using 13 data sets and then applying it in the one remaining data set, the performance in that one holdout data set that is different from all the 13 previous ones is fairly similar to the original data. So the model was generalizable to a certain extent. So we did find that for one parameter of calibration, there was heterogeneity and it would indicate the need for some recalibration, but that was a rather, the amount of recalibration for that would be rather minimal. So about 4 years ago, so I received a VENI grant to work out some of my ideas to improve this further. And so one of the methods we have been working on now the last couple of years, and we're just working on a revision for statistics in medicine. So, but basically what we did is we expanded the idea of internal external cross-validation, and we made a sort of stepwise estimation procedure that tries to explore the space of all the variables that you have in your data set, and that tries to find the combination of variables in your data set that gives you the best external validity. So it kind of tries to exploit the heterogeneity that you see in your different data sets, and it tries to find variables that explain these differences in performance across data sets, and does it construct a model that not just focuses on optimal performance within those 13 studies, but that also tries to optimize performance in that holdout 14 study. So it tries to find a balance between both reproducibility in your 13 studies, but also in towards transportability in your leave out 14 study. And so I mentioned the word balance because that's a really tricky one, because what we also found is that you cannot achieve both, at least in our examples, we could not achieve both optimal internal validity and optimal external validity. So you have to find somewhere there is a trade-off between if you want to perform well in the holdouts study, you need to make some concessions, you know, in the 13 studies that you are using for model development. It's very similar to the bias variance trade-off that you have in the tree of statistical lectures. So, but at least so we built on this trade-off, and we developed some new metrics of generalizability that we incorporated together with internal external cross-validation, so that you can develop a prediction model that either focuses on optimal internal validity or on optimal external validity, or some combination of both internal and external validity. And it then gives you a somewhat different model that you would obtain if you would just apply, I don't know, like a traditional regression that, you know, that does not exploit this information. And so this is a method we've implemented in MetaMisk, but it's not fully published yet. And then we are further working on these ideas to adopt penalty metrics that not only account for the magnitude of the regression coefficients, but also penalize for the amount of heterogeneity in your data. So that essentially would try to develop a model that is not so prone to heterogeneity as other models. So we would try to make your model, to simplify your model towards a target that is where the regression coefficients are not extremely large, but also where the regression coefficients are fairly stable across the different studies that are in your population. Other than that, within the recoded program, we've been working for methods to adjust for measurement error. Why is this important? Well, because another issue when you combine data from different sources is that the data is often measured using different instruments and in different also in different times or in different, you know, in the quality of the data can be different. And so these differences may also affect the accuracy of your prediction model and the heterogeneity in your data. So accounting for these differences becomes important, especially when you want to make predictions in a new population where, you know, the method of measuring your I don't know, not age, but let's say the measuring the blood pressure is done using a particular instrument. But in your development data set, the instruments that were used to measure, let's say, the blood pressure is not the same as the instrument that you would be using in your new population, or it is the same only for a few studies. So essentially, you then need to somehow match your instrument to the instrument that is available in the data sets that is relevant for your particular setting. And then some other methods we've been working on is to disentangle the variation in performance that is attributed to invalid model coefficients versus the variation that can be attributed to the fact that you're dealing with different patients with different characteristics. And then my final, let me just check the time. Yeah, because I see it's almost, maybe I should just skip the treatment effect modeling. Maybe we have some time for questions.
Yes, exactly, Thomas. I was actually thinking that maybe I should warn you that you're reaching the end. Thanks. Yeah, so let's say 2 minutes so that we still have a few minutes for questions.
Yeah, let me have a look. So I'll go to one or two slides and of the treatment effect modeling. So, I mean, my whole talk was essentially moving towards this topic because this is the, I think, the next new thing, what people are doing and what people are interested in, because eventually why we're making all these prediction models is really, in the end, is to really to make to facilitate decision making. And in healthcare, a lot of decision making is oriented around interventions and treatments. So, I mean, we are all developing these prediction models to predict, I don't know, the outcome of mortality, the risk of mortality or the risk of, complications or something like that. But in none of these prediction models, treatment is an element of the model. So we always assume that these predictions are for, let's say, if I stay untreated, something like that. So I could, so all these models, for instance, would predict my risk of death if I stay untreated. And so this risk can be very high or it can be very low. And then I assume that treatment will improve my risk, but I never know exactly for me as an individual, how much will I benefit from this treatment? I just know that, look, if I don't get treated, this is my likely outcome. And I know by reading, I don't know, the literature, some randomized trials, I might know, okay, if I take this intervention, my relative risk will decrease by, I don't know, 30%. So I can make some simple calculations and kind of, you know, indirectly kind of get a guess of how much I will benefit from treatment, but it's very, you know, it's very ad hoc. So ideally what we want is to have a model that just directly gives you an answer to this question, right? To have a model that gives you two predictions, right? What is the outcome that I will have if I am not treated? And what is the outcome I will experience if I do get a treatment? And of course, if there are multiple treatments, I mean, it will be more than two predictions, but that's the main idea. And so these models are very similar to prediction models. The only difference is that treatment becomes a really important part of these prediction models. And also the causal inference becomes an important part because we really want to make sure that the difference in predicted risk for if I follow treatment A versus if I don't follow treatment A, that difference in outcome risk should be really reflecting, you know, the benefit from treatment and not some other, some random differences because, you know, I'm mixing up all sorts of patients. And so counterfactual framework and causal inference becomes really important in this kind of modeling task. And so methods for this have been lacking. I mean, they're really unavailable. So, I mean, in theory, you can apply all the regression and machine learning that you want, but to do it right, it's an all other question. Because, I mean, the fact that we really want to have some counterfactual prediction means that we need to think about, causal effects, but also that we still need to make reliable prediction models. And on top of that, we also need to think about causal effects. So it becomes very complicated to make this kind of treatment effect prediction models that are accurate and reliable. And this is so just some background. So let me just see. So we've done a lot of simulations in this area, so I'll skip this as well. But what we found mainly is that methods that are available so far for this kind of purposes, in theory, you know, they can be applied to, I don't know, if you have like a couple of randomized trials, you can you know, let them loose on these trials and come up with a model. So in theory, you can do all this fancy modeling, but the reality is that many of these models, they are not accurate, and they're not, it's very difficult to make them accurate because you need a lot of data to estimate these models. And often you don't have a lot of data, especially if, when we talk about RCTs, it's not like, you can, they're quite costly to run and to also to obtain the patient level data from more than one RCT. So it's a very expensive endeavor to engage in this kind of research. So a common theme in this kind of modeling is that you have small data. Even if you have data from multiple trials, you have limited amount of data. So the general elements that come back in this kind of questions is that shrinkage will even be more important than for traditional prognostic models. The causal inference, blending the causal inference with the prediction also becomes really important. So, this is an area of ongoing research. And we find that some methods that have been proposed recently are not very adequate or perhaps even misleading. This is an area where further research is urgently needed. And this is what we are working on at the moment.